Howdy folks, and welcome back to Let's Play The Elder Scrolls 3 Morrowind, as brought to you by my amazing supporters on Patreon. They're all amazing. You guys are all awesome. I love you all. Anyways, so we gotta find a person here. We are looking for Mayra Milo, and she's apparently, well, they, I guess, are in the library, which I got lucky, apparently. And here we are. All right. Thank you, Athalanthalas, for rescuing me. Now I'll stay here at Holomayan with Master Barelo and assist him with the monastery's library. Okay, so... let's tell her about Caius first. He's gone back to the Imperial City. He says he's been recalled. I wonder why. I never knew what he's thinking. I think he's involved in something secret, something dangerous. I was hoping he might help us. Now he's gone. I don't know what to think. So, how about this Dagoth Ur fellow? Dagoth Ur is the immortal enemy of the Tribunal Temple cult. The temple holds Dagoth Ur and his hosts accountable for all the evils that beset the Dunmer and Morrowind. Dagoth Ur dwells within the fiery caverns beneath Red Mountain, served by his kin called Ash Vampires, and by a legion of deformed monsters. Okay, so tell me about the... I think the Nerevarine prophecies here. Let me check and see what we're supposed to... Okay... it doesn't really specifically say what we're supposed to talk about, so we'll just ask her about everything then. Alright, so we already know about the Divine Intervention Scroll, so how about the Nerevarine Cult? As I said, the dissident priests have a book called The Progress of Truth, which gives their views on their beliefs of the Nerevarine Cult. Alright, and the prophecies? This is the usual prophecies, persecuted by the temple. Okay, we've already done this, and persecution of the Nerevarine. Alright, so yeah, we already know all this, so we're supposed to find, I guess, we'll ask around here, how can I help you? tell me about the Nerevarine? Here we go. Our interest in the Nerevarine used to be a matter of principle, a willingness to consider the validity of mystical insights rejected by temple doctrine. Now, Dagoth Ur grows stronger while the Tribunal grows weaker, and the return of Saint Nerevar, even if only reborn in spirit, may be our best prospect of salvation. Alright. Well, tell me about Nerevar. By the way, here are a few books from our library you might find of interest. Each gives a very different impression of Nerevar. Alright, so we got some... The Real Nerevar, Nerevar Moon and Star, and Saint Nerevar. Alright, and the Sixth House. This is a new threat, not yet widely recognized as another face of the Devil Dagoth Ur. But it is clearly a sign of an incoming crisis, and the Temple may no longer be able to protect Morrowind. In such troubled times, the Dunmer may turn to the ancient pillars of faith, the Ancestors, and the Daedra, and especially to the prophetic visions granted by Lord Azura. Then they may look to the Nerevarine, Saint Nerevar Reborn, to lead them against the grim armies of Dagoth Ur. Okay, what do you have to say about Dagoth Ur? So long as the Ordinators, Buoyant Armagers, and the Tribunal could contain the Blight and Dagoth Ur's creatures within the Ghost Fence, faith in the Temple's protective power was strong. But now travelers and settlements suffer from Blight Storms and marauding monsters, and the people fear the Temple is losing its ages-old battle with the Devil Dagoth Ur. Okay. Dissident Priests? While we are just getting all kinds of journal information about this. A significant part of the temple hierarchy might be more inclined to accept and tolerate differences in opinion and dogma, but other parts of the temple, in particular the Ordinators under Beryl Sala, claim that the threat from Red Mountain and Dagoth Ur can only be resisted with a unified, resolute faith. The people are afraid, so they support the hard line, but if we can show ourselves able to confront Dagoth Ur more effectively than the Ordinators, the temple and the people will support us. Okay, tell me about the Lost Prophecies. I've reviewed the Apocrypha, and I found I don't even know what the Apocrypha is. Oh man, we got... this is why I waited for another episode, because I figured we were going to be getting kind of like a lore dump here. I've reviewed the Apocrypha, and I found two passages of particular interest. We've made copies of these passages to give you. Many are familiar with the two Nerevar prophecies current among the Ashlanders, called the Stranger and the Seven Vision. We have two other prophecies, the Lost Prophecy and the Seven Curses, that may offer additional insights into the riddles surrounding the coming of the Incarnate. Perhaps these are the lost prophecies that your friend Ebony Mesa told you about. We've also prepared a document for you called Kagranak's Tools. This document will explain to you and to others the terrible secret that the temple conceals about the true history of the Tribunal and the corrupt nature of their divine powers. It is concealed this secret that the temple persecutes the Nerevarine and the dissident priests. This persecution must stop. We must be united against the true enemy, Dagoth Ur, and if you are the Nerevarine, you must lead us against him. Alright, well, what is the Apocrypha? The Hierographa are the collected priestly writings of the temple. The Apocrypha are the hidden writings, secrets known only to the hidden levels of priesthood and inquisition. Defying the temple, we have gathered as much of the Apocrypha as we can here in Holomayan. One of the chief disputes between the temple and the dissident priests is that the temple hides the truth from its followers. Oh, that's nice. Okay, tell me about the Lost Prophecy. From the seventh sign of the 11th generation, neither Hound nor Gore nor Seed nor Harrow, but Dragonborn and Far Star Marked, Outlander incarnate beneath Red Mountain. Blessed Guest counters seven curses. Star Blessed Hand wields thrice cursed blade to reap the harvest of the unmourned house. I've annotated your copy of the Lost Prophecy with our best efforts at interpretation, but a rough summary might be an Outlander, foreign-born but welcome as a guest, confronts seven curses beneath Red Mountain. His hand, blessed by Azura, uses a cursed blade to bring justice to House Dagoth, or House Dwemer, or both. The Nervarine, an Outlander, that wouldn't please many Ashlanders, and it may explain how the prophecy got lost. The cursed blade, in the very end of this, I guess you might want to skip ahead, like, 60 seconds, because this is going to be kind of a spoiler. The Cursed Blade, you need two items. Well, actually, I think it's three items to finally, like, finish the game. And one of them, I believe, is a cursed sword. So, let us go ahead and ask him about the seven curses. The seven curses reads as follows. Through the doors of the unmourned house was scoffers scoff and schemers scheme. From the halls of the oath-breaking house rings seven curses of gods blasphemed. First curse, curse of fire. Second curse of ash. Third curse of flesh. Fourth curse of ghosts. Fifth curse of seed. Sixth curse of despair. And seventh curse of dreams. Your copy of the seven curses bears our guesses at interpreting the verses. In short form, they come from House Dagoth or House Dwemer or both. Fire and ash come from Red Mountain. Flesh is corpus. Ghosts, seed, and despair are unclear. But curse of dreams seems to refer to your recent cases of soul sickness and sleeper attacks in the towns. Okay. Do we have anything else? I think that is everything. So we bid him farewell and... Okay, so... See, Dagoth Ur grows stronger. He sees this return of St. Nerevar, that being us, tentatively. Even though it is only the spirit. Let's see, he gave us some books. Appearance of the Sixth House is a sign of coming crisis. St. Nerevar is to lead the people, I guess, against the grim armies of Dagoth Ur. Alright, so this is actually just a lot of what he told us, and we've just noted it down. That's actually kind of handy that they give you references. Especially, I want to check. Let's see here. What do we got here? Here's Kagranak's tools. Let's see. The seven curses. So, like, is this... yeah, they actually give us notes. This is actually, wow. Like, this is, I like it. They're giving us all kinds of information here. But I think the first thing I'm going to read is Kagranak's tools. Summarized from the Apographa. Beneath Red Mountain, Dwemer miners discovered a great magical stone. By diverse methods, Lord Kagranak, high priest and mage crafter of the ancient Dwemer, determined that the magical stone was the heart of the god Lorkhan. Cast here in the Dawn Era as punishment for his mischief in creating the mortal world. Determined to use its divine powers to create a new god for the exclusive benefit of the Dwemer, Kagranak forged three great enchanted artifacts. Okay, here we go. So this, this is what I had thought was spoilers previously, but they're actually just going to tell us what they are. Okay, so Kagranak forged three great enchanted artifacts, which are called Kagranak's tools. Wraithguard is an enchanted gauntlet to protect its wearer from destruction when tapping the heart's power. Sunder is an enchanted hammer to strike the heart and produce the exact volume and quality of power desired. Keening is an enchanted blade that is used to flay and focus the power that rises from the heart. Now, essentially how this works is to wield Sunder or Keening. If you wield them, like, in your bare hands, it kills the shit out of you. It deals, like, a really high damage over time effect to you. Wraithguard will allow you to wield one of them without dying, essentially. When Kagranak used these tools on the heart in the Battle of Red Mountain, no one knows what happened, but the Dwemer race disappeared entirely from the mortal world. Lord Nerevar and Lord Dagoth retrieved these tools and didn't know what to do with them. Nerevar asked Dagoth to guard the tools while he went to consult with his counselors, Vivek, Almalexia, and Sothasil. He left and spoke with the three counselors, and they decided to return together to Red Mountain to decide what to do. But while Nerevar was gone, Dagoth was tempted and confused by the power of the tools. When Nerevar and the counselors arrived, he refused to give up the tools, claiming he had sworn to Nerevar to protect them. Then Dagoth fought with Nerevar and the counselors and was mortally wounded and driven off, and the tools were recovered. Then, Nerevar and his counselors decided to take the tools for safekeeping. They all swore a great oath never to use the tools, but after Nerevar's death, Vivek, Almalexi, and Sothasil yielded to temptation. They took these tools themselves and went to Lorcan's heart, buried beneath Red Mountain, and gave themselves divine powers. But Dagoth had not died. We don't know what happened, but this is what we believe. His experiments with the Kagranax tools had joined him to the heart's divine nature in some way, so that he learned to draw power directly from the heart. We conjecture that Dagoth Ur, driven by anger and greed, used the heart without caution and restraint, and, as a result, has become terribly powerful and terribly mad. But the Tribunal showed great care and restraint in their use of the tools, and so they were not driven mad, and they did many good things. Nonetheless, the Tribunal too appear to have been corrupted by the heart's power, though more subtly. Kagranax tools are cursed. Stealing power from the heart of a god is a terrible folly and fated to disaster. The Tribunal is losing its battle to control the power of the heart. They are sustained by the same tainted power that drives Dagoth Ur mad. They grow weak and cannot protect us from Dagoth Ur, but even if they could, would we be wise to worship gods such as these? They conceal the truth from us out of shame, they persecute the Nerevarain and the dissident priests out of shame when they should be welcoming them and enlisting their aid against Dagoth Ur. The Tribunal have done much good for Morrowind and the Dunmer, but they succumbed to the temptation of Kagranax tools, and through these, and though these tools once may have seemed the instruments of salvation, now they must seem as instruments of doom. Okay, so, that right there, what we get from that is, first, Dagoth Ur has tied himself to Lorcan's heart, and the three Kagranax tools, Wraithguard, Keening, and Sunder, can be used to screw with the heart and destroy it. So to kill Dagoth Ur, we have to destroy the heart. To destroy the heart, we have to find the three artifacts. That is our current, like, overarching endgame goal right now, is to find those artifacts. So, let's poke around a little bit more. More people here to bother. Hey there, buddy. Everyone knows you've got a price on your head. I don't want any trouble. Just leave me alone and I won't call the guard. What?
Come on.
What?
Say something or move on.
What did I do that got me a bounty on my head? Weird. Will you actually talk to me? Yeah, they'll talk to me still. Okay, I have a feeling that... Return to Vivek. Vivrana Arian, a monk of the docks outside, can arrange for travel back to Vivek. You can only enter or leave Holy Mayan at dusk and dawn. The entrance is sealed at all their hours. But please make yourself comfortable here. Rest in our beds and make good use of our services. You may read our books, but don't take them. Do not abuse our hospitality. Do not take personal items or alchemical apparatus or ingredients or other private property. Uh-huh.
Wealth.
Yeah, I'm not gonna... Ooh, I'm not gonna take anything. What is this? Oh, that's a fishing pole. For a second, I thought that was like a katana or something. So what do we have here? You're an alchemist. Let's see. Oh, and an enchanter. Which means... Let's see here. Do I have anything yet? You don't... You're freaking... Oh, yeah, those are bottles. I was gonna say, you're an alchemist and you don't sell things, but no, he's like more of an enchanter than an alchemist, it would appear.
Speak your needs.
Hello. What do? You will train me in some things. We can just train our acrobatics up really high. That's tempting.
You may speak.
Okay, who are you? You don't really have anything for me. I mean, I suppose I could ask these people about. Mara Mirlo has run terrible risks remaining at the Hall of Wisdom and Truth, and we are grateful that you have rescued her from the Ministry of Truth. Yeah, these guys are kind of dicks.
What is it, Sarah?
Oh my god. Get over there. There we go. Hey, you look like just rando person standing around here. By you. You're a known criminal. I will have nothing to do with you until you... Yaddy, yaddy, yaddy. Nope. Alright, so yeah, it appears that these two are the big lore dump over here. So I don't think they've got anything else.
It is such an honor to meet you.
Yeah, we can't ask her about any of the more advanced books. That's all this guy. So let's see what other goodies we have here, because we have, the Lost Prophecy, which is the one he just told us about. So, all right, of ancient family, but not of the four great Ashlander cults, born under fallen stars, the Imperial Science. So this is us, because we were, I think in the intro it says that we came here from an Imperial prison, so. Outlander incarnate appears as a formal epithet, stressing the linkage between the words. The Outlander incarnate is a blessed guest. So that probably has to do with, the Urshilaku, I believe, the tribe up north. Not born of the tribes, but accepted as a guest with rites of health and hospitality, yeah. Under Red Mountain, he will confront and balance against the seven curses, which we will look at here next. Starblast suggests Azura, the Daedra Lord and patron of magic, fate, and prophecy. Thrice-Cursed Blade may refer to a weapon called Keening, yeah, there's the sword, associated with certain legends of the Battle of Red Mountain, and the Dreamer Craftlord Kagranak, Reap the Harvest, is a reference to the proverb, you harvest from the seeds you plant, which means you get what your labors deserve, in both a positive sense of reward and the negative sense of punishment. The Unmourned House could either be both the, be either or both of the Lost Great Houses of the Dunmer, House Dreamer, or House Dagoth. All right. And where was the other one? Seven curses. Okay, so this is just... Okay, so lines 1-3, which is fire, ash, and flesh. I'm just gonna skim this really quick. It may refer to unspecified broken oaths of peace between Lord Nerevar and Lord Dumak, founders of the Grand Council. The Dumar were the mockers and profaners of the divine. Curses of fire and ash would come from Red Mountain, where Dagoth Ur rules. Earliest reported threats from Red Mountain. Curses of the flesh suggests blight diseases, especially Corpus, which we have passed the curse of flesh, do not forget. And 8 to 10 are obscure. What are 8 to 10? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Go see in despair. Alright, yeah, we don't know what those are. And then 11, reports of soul sickness and disturbed things. Alright. So now let's have a look at the real Nerevar. It's a Telvanni retainer's informal history of Nerevar. Lists no sources. Oh, there's only a couple pages, so I'm gonna read this. When the Dunmer followed Veloth to Morrowind, they were many warring clans, with no law or leader in common. One Dunmer warlord, Nerevar, had the ambition to rule all of them. In that time, House Dreamer were great enchanters, so Nerevar went in secret to a Dreamer smith and asked for an enchanted ring that would help him. The ring gave its wearer great powers of persuasion. For safety, it was enchanted to instantly kill anyone who wore it, except Nerevar. The ring was called Moon and Star, and it helped Nerevar unite the various clans into the First Council. That's interesting. So, I don't know if this is something that we will need to wear, but if it is, we will, obviously. Challenge put forth by Outrider notwithstanding. If I need to use something to win the game, we will do so. Later, however, disputes over religion divided the council, with House Dreamer and House Dagoth on one side and all of the other houses on the other. Dreamer and Dagoth invited Orc and Nord clans as allies and held Northwest Morrowind, while Nerevar mustered the other houses and nomad tribes and marched to meet the Dreamer Dagoth Westerner forces. Okay. The armies met at Red Mountain, a Dreamer stronghold. The Dreamer were defeated, with great slaughter and terrible sorceries used, resulting in the utter extermination of House Dreamer, House Dagoth, and their allies. Nerevar was killed in the battle and his ring lost, but his alliance survives in Morrowind's ruling political institution, the Grand Council. Alright! Shit, guys, lore dump. All right, so I think I'm actually gonna call this here. I have a couple ideas for where we're going to be turning within the next couple episodes. This should prove interesting, and I hope to see you all then. Hope you enjoyed this episode, and I'll catch y'all next time. Until then, take it easy.